You're listening to the Ask Drone You podcast. You ask, we answer your drone questions. Whether you're here to turn your passion into profit or you simply fly for fun, we're a community of learners and teachers who aspire to achieve greatness. We are
Drone You.
Hey, Rob.
Yes, Paul.
Have you ever broken a drone before?
No.
I have.
I know a lot of people that have them.
I do too. And that's why I think we should tell them about unmannedsas.com/droneu.
Cool.
Because, well, if you like supporting veteran-based businesses, if you like supporting businesses based out of the United States, and you need to get your drone fixed quickly, well, then you've got to check out the guys at unmannedsas.com/droneu. As a listener of this podcast, you'll get a sweet deal. It's going to cost you $29.95. That'll include shipping your drone out to these guys. But if you elect to get your drone fixed with them, you'll get $20 back towards fixing that drone. So make sure you check them out if you do ever have a little accident. unmannedsas.com/droneu. Also want to say a quick thank you to another one of our sponsors, Charki. Charki is a Peruvian-style lamb jerky. Why lamb over beef? Very simple. Higher in protein, lower in fat. And what does Charki actually mean? It's the Peruvian ancient Incan style of preserving meats without chemicals. So the boys at Ranch Line All Natural that make Charki, well, they decided, how do we make truly all natural foods? Let's take it back to the old days and do it like the old guys did. So that's what they did. This gluten-free, chemical-free, nitrate-free, delicious lamb jerky will be sure to surprise you. Now for me, whenever I'm out on the road, I actually love this stuff, Rob, because it really hits the spot without making me feel like crap, without wearing me down. It tastes amazing. And I wouldn't promote it and let it be on the show unless it was truly good and Rob liked it.
Liked, as in best tense. I love it, it's great stuff. And you gave all those frees. This is not sugar-free, but it's gluten-free.
It's gluten-free.
Nitrate-free, mm-hmm. But it is flavorful. Check it out.
Oh, it's really good. Check it out. It's on Amazon. You can buy it only on Amazon. Just go to charki.love. Yes, that's a website. In your URL bar, charki.love, because we think you'll love lamb. Well, anyway, guys, welcome to another awesome episode of Ask Drone You. My name is Paul.
And my name is Rob, and this is episode number 522. Thank you guys for hanging out with us today. Hope you are having a great week.
Yes, thank you very much for hanging out with us today. I will say I'm a little on the slow side again. I did something to my leg yesterday to immobilize myself. I'm not quite sure.
There are not many ways to slow Paul down, but an injury is one of them.
Yes, it sure is. Oh, man. But, you know, guys, excited to be here. Got a lot to talk about this week. We will be recording quite a few shows because we are filming so many classes. Right now, there's a bunch coming out. John McBride's thermal class, if you know him from Rocky Mountain Unmanned Systems. We've got Sean Taylor, aka Night Fury's class, coming out. We just released a couple classes. We were doing some workflow, some automation classes that are on there. And then we've got a whole new Mavic Pro Don't Crash course. Just finished filming that. Phantom 4 Pro Don't Crash course, that's coming out. And then I'm doing a class on the specifics of flying over water. So for all of you who have been wanting to fly around boats, for those of you that I know that watch the show that own a boat, which is quite a few of you, it will be one of those classes that you will definitely not want to miss.
Yeah, that's a lot of stuff. And you didn't even mention the 107, which is happening today and tomorrow.
Yeah, I'm hoping that Ted teaches most of it today, to be honest with you, because I don't know how long that can be on my foot for.
Fair enough.
But,
fair enough.
We talked about this yesterday. A lot of our members have actually said, well, I checked out Remote Pilot 101, but I wanted the community, I wanted the extra classes, and you guys were cheaper than them. So a lot of those people also said, though, I would love to see another classification. A different kind of style to get the 107 material. So now at DroneU, there are going to be multiple ways to take the same test.
Yeah, to get the same information, because not everybody learns the same way. So we're going to have the written part. We're going to have one long, essentially long live style learning process like you're in the classroom, and then more of a sort of step-by-step I think that's going to pretty much cover everybody's learning style.
Definitely. So whatever floats your boat, you'll be able to get.
That's right.
So, anyway, Rob, let's play that question and talk about how we can mitigate misunderstandings with our clients.
Hi, Paul and Rob. I'm Jack. I live in Wisconsin and I work a full-time job in manufacturing. I also have a part-time side business where I create websites for small mom-and-pop shops and the local municipalities in the area. Last summer, a friend of mine who owned a drone agreed to do some footage for me over a lake, and it turned out super great. The image quality just blew me away. My client was super happy, I think partly because they also got that for free. I seen the potential of the technology, and so I went out and I bought my own drone, and in December, I passed my 107. And now I have jobs lined up for spring and summer, and I'm practicing like crazy, always trying to strive for buttery smooth, even though it's pretty cold outside. I've also been learning how to edit and produce the video footage, which I discovered takes a little longer and actually much longer than the actual flight times. My question is, what preventative measures do you take to ensure the client is going to be satisfied with the end result without having to do another shoot or spend crazy amount of time re-editing? I'm excited to have found Drone You. You guys do an amazing job. Keep up the great work. Thank you.
Very kind, Jack. Thank you so much for that. And guys, if you have a question, go to askdroneyou.com like Jack did and get that into us, and we will get on that just as soon as we can. So, interesting question.
I love it. I love when people ask these questions because they're thinking about, you know, how can I help, kind of bottle the expectations from my client to make sure I focus on my deliverables, but also focus on making them happy.
Yeah, and the guy is doing, Jack's doing a little bit of planning. So planning is always a good thing. When you think through what you need to accomplish before you go try to accomplish it, you're going to end up with something better.
Oh, agreed.
And 100%. I think that's what he's doing here. I think that's great.
100%. So just a heads up for anyone out there, if you are a DroneU member and you listen to the show, there is a form that we already have pre-built for this. It's for real estate videography and photography, but you can really use it for a lot of other jobs and whatnot. Mm-hmm. And this form actually goes through, you know, what's the deliverable? What's the video size? How many photos does this person want? Are there certain things that they want to cover? Did they clean the house? Did they dust the house? Did they wipe down the windows? Did they turn on the lights inside and out? You know, and sometimes if you want a really flashy looking house for real estate, water the lawn, water the plants right before you fly it,
right,
and it'll blow your mind.
It'll glisten.
Yeah, yeah, it's amazing. So now if you're in Wisconsin, that's probably not a good idea right now.
You'll slip and fall on the ice.
So we do have a form already. If you go into the DroneU community, click your dashboard and resources under forms, you'll find this form. But this form definitely helps people control expectations, because first of all, what I like to do that I've been finding on top of this form is, if someone has an idea of what they want to see, just straight up ask them. Say, hey, are there a couple styles of videos that you like? Show me some things that you like. And then, you know, what I would say to my clients is, all right, well, tell me what you'd like. Tell me what you'd like to show, what you'd like to highlight and feature. And I pretty much say, like, you know, I'm willing to give you one round of revisions after I edit a video. And I'd like you to, in writing, systematically go through what you would like to change. But I want you to know that we will not go back and reshoot anything. So if there's something specific that you want, you need to tell us now.
Yeah.
And put it on that form. Mm-hmm. And when they put it on the form, that's holding them accountable for what they wrote down, but it's also helping you control expectations, because they're like, well, I told you I wanted you to film the turret. And they're
right.
Like, what? You didn't write that down.
Yeah.
And then you're like, well, I apologize. You know, I don't really have any footage of that, but if you would have told me on the form, I would have happily taken care of that for you.
I think that's a great idea. And what you're speaking to, and I think it's step one to answering his question, is make sure you have an understanding of what your client wants. I think one of the things to add to what you just said that's incumbent upon you as the pilot, the creative, whatever you want to call it, is to certainly understand what they want, but also give them ideas.
Yeah.
Sort of feed off what they say to you. Like, I would really like this. And you're like, okay, that's great. We can do that. But we could also do this. Or what if we did it this way? And just because they're not going to have the experience that you have, obviously.
Totally.
They're not going to have seen it through the lens that you've seen it. So the more that you can kind of draw out of them what they want, because oftentimes they don't even know. They have an idea, but they don't really know. The better off you're going to be in the end.
Well said, Rob. Well said. It's so true. You know, one of the things that you can do too, guys, is if you have created similar videos to what your client is asking for, you can say, look, I did this video, it was $5,000, and you know, we did some groundwork, we did some time lapse, mm-hmm. we did some aerial stuff, and you know, for $10,000, we did a hyperlapse, and we did all this and that, and you know, it took a bunch of days, but this is now their new marketing video. I think if you do provide examples of what you can deliver and set the expectation therein, that's another great way yeah. to help manage expectations. Now, if you are doing real estate, you're doing videography or photography, I would highly recommend that you take let the realtor take you through a tour of the house. Now, I have noticed, Rob, in looking at houses mm-hmm. recently, there are some realtors that just say, go into the house and look around. And there are some realtors that take you in the house, making sure to illustrate certain points of the house.
And you would prefer option B.
Correct. I would prefer the latter mm-hmm. because then I know what that person is thinking. And right. I normally just open up my phone and open up the recording app. I know a lot of people are really weird about, you know, being recorded. Mm-hmm. But if you have an Amazon Alexa or Amazon Echo, it records you all the time.
Yeah.
So
it's a whole nother topic of the conversation.
So anyway, I just record the person as they're talking so that way I can save the address and the realtor's name in my phone. And if I need to go back while I'm editing mm-hmm. and listen to what they were saying about the house, I can pick up on little tidbits to be like, okay, let's do this. Okay, let's do that. But I will say that most of my clients, once they give me kind of a general outline of what they want, I like working for people who give me a little bit of freedom and flexibility. Like, what's your goal? Mm-hmm. You clearly want to sell this to people. And you, like, for example, I've got one client, land broker. He lets me do my thing 100%. He's like, I've seen all your work and I love it. Just go do your thing.
So you've built trust with him.
Yeah.
He's seen what you can do and he trust you to do that for him.
Yes.
Yeah.
And then I have another client, a luxury hotel client, who says, well, I want you to shoot the hotel, a couple bits of the inside, a couple bits of the outside, but I want you to go out and shoot the tourist activities. I want people to see beyond the hotel.
Yeah.
I want people to see. And Ilker said this best, and he's not here right now, but Ilker was like, you know, what a lot of people are looking for in travel now is no longer to be a tourist, but rather to be an explorer. What can they go do that's different from the average thing? And that's what this particular hotel wanted me to show. And that's what we did. So oftentimes we spend one day at the hotel and two or three days out and about shooting activities.
It's a rough life, that drone life.
Hey, if you want to live the drone life, go to droneyoubook.com and pick it up and you'll get the formula on how I did it.
So well done.
I wouldn't promise that you could make a six-figure business unless I did it myself. So I have done that. He has seen the financial proof. We're good. You can do it too. If I can do it and work for Drone U at the same time, you can do it and have a part-time or full-time job as well.
That's right.
So,
Jack, we're talking to you.
Yeah.
So a couple of things that I think maybe we could add to this as far as preventive measures. One, I think, would be to be very prepared, right, with your equipment, with
oh man, you know how I am about equipment.
Your skill, like
my office is a mess, but my equipment is yeah. like perfectly put away. And
because a lot of these sites in particular that you go to, you might have to travel a long ways, and the bottom line is if you don't get the right shots the time that you go out, in a lot of cases you're going to try to make do with what you did get.
Mm-hmm.
And you're probably going to fall short if that's the approach that you end up taking. So the more preparation that you do before you go, the more you make sure you've got the right equipment,
yeah.
all those kinds of things, I would consider, to directly answer your question, Jack, those are preventative measures.
Totally. And one other thing that I, as you're sitting here talking, that I have to remind myself, even to this day, that I have to do every time, is back in the day in the Phantom 2, you know, I only had one or two batteries starting up
yeah.
this business. And I had to get as many cinematic shots in those two batteries as possible.
The good old days.
Now, the good old days. But that being said, now when I fly, I still ask myself, did I get multiple angles of the same thing? Did I get cinematic shots of the same thing in a different angle? How many cinematic shots did I get in this one particular battery? And if I didn't get at least 15 cinematic movements in one Phantom 4 battery, that was a failure in flight. That's how
I
look at
it. So you like put a quota per battery.
I have to because I'm human and I love to be creative and I love to just go look at stuff. Like one time I was flying in this restricted airspace and I had the waiver for it and I had the permission, everything I needed. And there was this guy down there with a Phantom himself, just willy-nilly, not licensed, nothing. Went up and even talked to him later. He oblivious to the fact there was even licensing.
I love those.
Yeah.
I'd almost give that guy more credit for ignorance than for just not doing it. But anyway, that's another point.
Oh, yeah. Well, let's not go down that rabbit hole because we could follow the white rabbit a long way.
Yes,
but that being said, I flew in because I wanted to see what he looked like just to be like, who's this guy? You know, you know how we all get when we see other people who don't know the rules or follow them. It's a little annoying. And by the way, I just want to reiterate, if you do run into someone like that, just remember the thing to do is to educate people. And right now at DroneU, we're working on something to send out to DroneU members, like a very specific thing that will, in a very nice way, inform people of the rules and give them a special invitation to learn more about it without hurting their emotional well-being. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and it'll include a link that says getanattorney.com.
No.
No, I'm just kidding.
It'll be something more like learn to elevate your experience, thedroneu.com. It's one of those things, going back to the expectations, we talked about asking them, the client, to show us videos that they like. You having examples of videos as deliverables, because remember, you want to set the expectations for deliverables. Are you doing ground? Are you doing just drone? Drone and ground? A little Osmo, a little this, a little that. What are you doing? For me, packages have always, 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 and still to this day, remain my bread and butter. I'm sure. Not just doing drone.
Right.
You know, I've got to have ground video. And that's why, we have the selection of cameras we have now, which is cool to shoot 1,000 frames a second now. But anyway, that being said, you have those deliverables. You have the form on the DroneU site with the questions pertaining to deliverables. I mean, what else can we offer here? We've talked about the tour. We've talked about, this seems to be just about everything.
Yeah, the only other thing that's coming to mind right now would be, and it's just kind of feeding off what you said about making sure you get certain shots and a certain number of shots per batteries, would be an actual checklist to make sure that happens.
Yeah.
We like to systematize things here, create systems that make sure we repeat a well-done process, so to speak, and checklists are often a big part of that. So, I don't know, maybe create a checklist that says this shot, this shot, this shot. And as I say that, you got to be careful that you don't get too rigid and that you maintain some room for flexibility and creativity.
Well, I think that's a great thing. What you're saying, if I'm hearing it right, is have a formula, but deviate every time from the formula in some way that creates a unique selling point.
That's well said.
Okay.
Beautiful.
Wow. All right. Well, on that bombshell, I better end this podcast quickly.
It's like getting a hole in one.
Anyway, guys, that is going to do it for us today. If you have a question, go to askdroneu.com and ask your question. Chances are, if you're thinking it, so is someone else. And if you ask the question, well, we get to say your name on radio, podcast, iTunes, whatever. Which, by the way, thank you, everyone. Keep sending in those reviews. Now, Living the Drone Life is the number one drone book on Amazon. Thank you so much. But also, thank you for the 100,000 listens already to the show this year.
Appreciate you guys.
So we went from 5,000 downloads a month to 10,000 downloads a month. To 90,000 downloads a month.
Yeah, it's awesome, and it's because of our partnership with you guys. So
yes,
thank you
and
very much.
Really, guys, we're doing it together, and that means the world to me. So thank you very much. My name is Paul.
My name is Rob.
This is Ask DroneU.